Penguin Random House Audio presents Heart of Fire, An Immigrant Daughter's Story. This is the author, Mazie K. Hirono. To my mother, Laura Chieko, who dared everything and whose compass is my surest guide. To my husband, Layton, who makes me laugh and inspires me to keep taking copious notes. Author's note. As with all memoirs, the dialogue in this narrative has been recreated from the author's best recollection and characterizes the spirit and substance of conversations rather than the precise words that may have been spoken. Preface. Necessary Fire. In one of my most vivid childhood memories, I am sitting on the curb next to the bus stop with my older brother Roy, waiting for our mother to get home. Three nights a week, after she leaves her day job as a typesetter at a Japanese language newspaper, she goes to work as a server for a caterer downtown. Roy is 11 and I am 9. Most days, after school, we play in the street and climb trees with boys from the neighborhood until late, and then we wait at the bus stop. A soft evening breeze cools our flushed faces as we sit chewing wads of wax candy, pleasantly tired from our games. In the tree branches above us, roosting sparrows ruffle their wings, their chatter mingling with the occasional rumble of passing cars. I think how different the night noises are here in Hawaii compared to the stillness of evenings in rural Japan where I was born. Roy and I jump to our feet at the sight of our mother's bus turning into Kivala Street. We crowd around the door as it opens, knowing Mom will be the only passenger getting off at this hour. On this night, when Mom steps off the bus, she stumbles and steadies herself with a hand on Roy's shoulder. She pauses, closes her eyes, and sucks in a deep breath. She looks pale and worn, and I realize that she's not feeling well. I watch her face closely as Roy and I walk slowly beside her to the white clapboard boarding house where we live together in a single small room. As soon as we are inside, Mom changes out of her white server's uniform and climbs under the sheets. She lies sideways across the mattress the three of us share, feet hanging off the side, careful to leave space for Roy and me. She refuses the bowl of rice that I have saved for her dinner and turns to the wall, a tiny moan escaping her. I touch her face. Her skin is on fire. I gather her clothes from the top of the dresser where she has neatly placed them, and find that the cloth is soaked through. I try to appear calm, but I'm frightened. Roy stretches out next to our mother, watching her sleep, his forehead creased. I can tell he's worrying too. Not knowing what else to do, I walk to the communal wash basin at the end of the hall, carrying Mom's uniform. Barely tall enough to reach the sink, I stand on a small step and drape the white cloth over the wooden washboard. I set about scrubbing the sweat stains from her clothes, working vigorously to distract myself from the fear that makes me feel hollow at the center. Mom has only one white service uniform and will need to wear it again for her next shift later in the week. I know how hard my mother works to keep us afloat, and I have already begun looking for ways to help her. Every day during the school year, Mom leaves two quarters on the table for Roy and me to buy lunch. A couple of times a month, she adds a dime for each of us. Roy always spends his dime, but I drop mine into the slot of a metal baseball piggy bank that Mom gave me. It is a cheap thing she picked up for a few cents, but I treasure it. In the evening before bed, I shake it, pleased by the jingle of coins. Some nights, I open the piggy bank and arrange the dimes in ever-lengthening rows on the floor, enjoying the simple fact of them. One evening, a few weeks before, I shook my piggy bank, anticipating its jingle, but it made no sound. I had to buy food, Mom explained when she arrived home later that night. Where my saved coins had been, there was now only the heaviness of a regret. It chased my own disappointment away instantly. It had taken me many months to save those coins, but I understood that Mom needed them. A few days later, she pressed a new coin in my palm. She folded my fist around it, smiling at me ruefully. The cool metal in my hand felt like a kind of promise as I pulled my piggy bank from under the bed and dropped the dime into its slot. Hearing its lonely clink, I knew there was nothing else to do but to begin saving again. Now I rinse Mom's uniform and hang it to dry on a communal line in the yard. By the time I get back to our room, Mom and Roy are both snoring softly. I sleep fitfully that night, alert to Mom's every movement and sigh. I'm half awake when she rises before daybreak as usual, dresses quietly so as not to disturb us, and leaves for her day job at the newspaper. After she's gone, I lie there, staring into the darkness. Beside me, Roy rolls onto his back and softly exhales. Even at that young age, I knew that there was no safety net to catch us should anything happen to our mother. 2 years earlier, she had fled her unhappy marriage and brought us to Hawaii. We'd had to leave my 3-year-old brother Wayne behind in Japan with my beloved maternal grandparents. He was too young to go to school, and there would be no one to take care of him while Mom worked. Wayne and my grandparents would be joining us soon, but in the meantime, our mother was all we had. A single parent, she worked 2 jobs for low wages, and if she couldn't work, we didn't eat. There was no question of her seeing a doctor, as we had no money for that and no health coverage. That childhood insecurity shaped the woman and the public servant I would become. It helped fuel my desire to study law and to position myself in rooms where I could advocate for those who were as vulnerable as our family had once been, as I had once felt. When, as a state legislator, I helped to pass laws that ensured safer working conditions and expanded healthcare coverage for Hawaii's families, I thought of my mother. When I advocated for public schools to have the resources they needed to serve all different types of learners, I thought of the teachers who had made a difference in my life and those who hadn't been able to help Wayne. And when, as a U.S. senator, I vociferously opposed the Trump administration's cruel and devastating family separation policy, I thought again of my brother Wayne, who would carry the scars of a much gentler separation for the entirety of his tragically short life. I have now spent 5 decades fighting for my constituents, while also navigating old boy networks in the staterooms of Hawaii and in the House and Senate chambers of Washington, D.C., creating a place for myself in political arenas dominated by men. For the vast majority of that time, I strove to be polite and civil, even as I fought tenaciously for the causes I believed in. From my earliest days in the Hawaii legislature, I schooled myself to bite back the snappish retorts that sprang to my lips at the chauvinistic nonsense that remains an inevitable part of American politics, not to mention the hypocrisy of colleagues who speak one way behind closed doors and vote another way on the floor. Though this restrained civility had clear roots in the cultures I was steeped in, that of both Japan and Hawaii, it was not my underlying nature. But given the expectations placed on women in politics, that we must be reasonable at all costs and never risk appearing to be overly emotional, it has seemed the most pragmatic approach to getting things done. After the 2016 election, however, I found I could no longer censor myself. I began to let loose my frustration and anger at the 45th administration's appalling practices and policies. From tearing little children away from their desperate asylum-seeking parents, to unleashing the hateful violence of white supremacists, to disparaging war veterans, to packing the nation's courts with ideologues. As I started publicly decrying in the strongest possible terms the lawless president and those who enabled him, I was heartened to discover that this merging of my private and public personas was embraced by my constituents, as well as by the Democrats and progressives across this nation who shared.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.